So as George and Rahul explained earlier, the Thumos 14 as compared to Thumos 13 has two main characteristics. First, we have completely untrained data. That's pretty crucial. We talked about it a lot for doing texture fusion in a realistic setting. It would never slip and probably manually train video on YouTube as well. So you really don't have to talk about it any further. Really, I think you agree with the importance of doing everything on a untrained data, especially the test work. And also, we have the background videos or non-videos. These are videos that, like, in which none of the actions that you're interested in occur. So they, having this in the testing and training allows us to do how well the existing texture fusion method is doing in terms of doing video level detection. That's obviously also very important for doing texture fusion in the system. So we have trained data, as George already explained earlier. This is trained VLL, training and trained data. They provide validation. These are untrained videos, relatively long videos, but they come with temporal annotation that brings for a soccer penalty, basically action. So a marker, a little marker, red marker on the side shows where the temporal annotation suggests the action is not occurring, and the turn green means that the action is happening. So you see that the color changes, and it does not remain green for most of the videos. So typically about less than 20% of the duration of the video is where the action happens. So the detection is really there, and it has to happen. And also testing is always untrained. So also for the quick lagging, and we have like 101 class of this type. Temporal detection happened in track happened for like some actions, but I have classification for entire 101. So we have two sub-competitions we talked about here. One of them is for temporal detection. You're given a video, you're interested in one particular action, you want to recognize where in the video temporally that action occurs. Also, we have the action classification. We don't care where in the video that action occurs, we just want to know whether it happened in this video or not. And obviously, this is a video level. So for the evaluation matrix that you're using is average precision. We are not using the traditional classification or multi-class classification accuracy. We obviously have the background data that can be incorporated. Average classification accuracy. So I'm sure you all have seen what average precision is, but if you have a classifier, we have about 1,500 test videos. The classifier, of course, for all these test videos returns a confidence. When you sort these videos based on this confidence value, ideally we would like to see the positive videos coming up top and negative videos. I think the action was like they're coming in the bottom. Precision recall curve in the area that gives us the average precision for one class. And to get the mean value of all the 101 classes, and becomes the mean average precision representative performance of one of them. So, to summarize, again, you saw this earlier today, we had 11 submissions from 11 teams, total number of 35 runs. Each team could submit up to 5 runs. The ground truth was withheld, so they wouldn't be able to know what run would be the best, but we would do the evaluation. We would take the best run, the best mean average position that's represented for each of the entries. And 3 submissions out of these 11 submissions were difficult. I would say dual purpose submissions basically are systems that can do both temporal detection and passive detection. And these tasks are obviously closer to the range of that, and we'll say more about it later. So this is to summarize the results of the most working classification track. So University of Amsterdam, the second round of University of Amsterdam with the best result, 0.71 mean average precision, which is pretty impressive. Andrea, here team, got the second best results, 0.67, and Ogozichi University and also Chinese University on OCF. So we have these 4 teams that can speak later today about their systems and present details. And also, I'll quickly overview them, because there'll be some specifics about them and some big ones about each of them, but you'll see the details as well. So like I said, if you're the mean average precision value would start from 0.7 and goes down to like a pretty low value. And by the but you'll see almost a linear like traffic between across all the teams. So we had a wide variety of methods applied in some certain aspects actually. Also each of these can have something to talk about, we'll see it later. Also, these like entries, they do not have the same performance for all classes. And so this plot shows that how regardless of the what the mean average precision is, the bracket shows actually the variance across different classes. So obviously some methods have a lower variance, for instance, the University of Southern California, some of them have less variance, you know, they more or less work very similar to their mean average precision for all classes. But you know, what we observe is that the majority of methods more or less show the same type of variance with respect to the three classes. They did not see a huge difference in that. So having background video actually allows to do a few interesting self-evaluations here. So the background videos are guaranteed not to improve any of the one-on-one classes, not just one of them. Each background video is actually retrieved for one primary action, but like George explained, we made sure that none of the one-on-one actions actually occur in that way. Since the video on the left is for the class yo-yo versus playing video, so the video on the right is for the class yo-yo for the primary action of playing yo-yo, but actually it's a background video because nobody's playing the yo-yo, but somebody's showing the yo-yo, and that's actually a video for yo-yo for sale, he's trying to sell the yo-yo, so he's showing the video, explaining them. But you know, obviously this is, in terms of the context, these two videos are very similar, right? In terms of the actions, one of them has an action, one of them doesn't. So it allows us, like I said, to do the evaluation, a few sub-evaluations to get into these methods and see what exactly we're doing. So for instance, we can say how well these submissions separate one positive video for the class that we're interested in from all the other positive videos of other classes and the background video. That's the full test set that we saw earlier. Another possibility, in fact, is if we discard the background videos from the test, what happens? Like the test set, we just get the subset of positive videos. Other videos of the class that you're interested in, and the other positive videos, do they have a very different behavior or pattern as compared to the other background videos of other classes or not? That's a question we won't answer, but this is basically a multi-class classification subset of our test. Another one that I personally like is quantifies the confusion of the context frames. So imagine like for each of the, for testing, classified are one of these actions, the test set is the positive videos of that action and the background videos of that action. So in this test set, the context is the same. Like all yo-yo playing videos and all some yo-yo videos, but not yo-yo playing. So this actually tells us, quantifies how much confusion is brought in by the context and how well these methods that we currently have can separate these. So here's the results of each of these different subsets. This is what we saw earlier, like I said, a complete test set. So the positive set, you know, the difference between, like I said, these two columns is the positive set does not have background videos. So as you can see, the average precision of all the methods slightly increased after you take the background videos out. That means that the existing methods that we have are doing a better job in terms of separating the positive videos of different classes in this multi-class setup that we have for action functions compared to identifying the video which does not have the action that you're interested in from anything else. Which is understandable. For years we have been defining action recognition as a multi-class classification. So this is the first time that we are actually bringing background videos in. It has been attracted in other geometries indirectly, but not action recognition. So this is not too surprising to see that there's a little bit of bias towards better performance when the background videos. So the third one, which was a little surprising at first blush, is when we saw the setup that I talked about. The context of the video is the same, but that's actually the only difference between them. So as you can see, the performance of all the methods is almost perfect, like very, very good. That means that the existing methods that we have, all these entries, they do a very good job in separating the yo-yo playing video like that from a video in which some context is common, some yo-yo is being shown, but no one Like I said, we would expect to see some confusions, a little bit of more confusion. But this is not actually too surprising when you look at how these entries work. Most of these entries, we'll talk about later, they work based on motion features. And the motion content of these two videos are obviously very different. So that's why this method would not be too confusing. We didn't have any method using objects directly or any kind of mid-level semantic basically concept taking into account. You can imagine that if we had some method which took into account, like there's a yo-yo, if there's a yo-yo, it suggests that there's an action yo-yo playing happening. It would be very likely to confuse this kind of videos and not get a very very high accuracy if it's not happening. But you know, we all know that in future, in practice, a comprehensive action recognition system should use semantic information. So we will have to see that. And when that kind of methods come around, then this kind of sub-evaluation, subset will tell us how much harm using the semantic information representations are doing along with the advantage. Right now, we are not using really the semantic information, so we don't really see any harm. It will change. So I'm going to very quickly go over the entries that we have and we'll see this later. So the first, the rank first method, here's the answer. They use motion features along with the visual number and classify it with the SPM. So basically the key points about this picture, or this method, is that everything is like more or less a standard pipeline. Like I said, motion features, vision monitoring to put together in SPM, but they the CNN was not trained in action, but it was trained in action. But they have their own tools. So the NDS set up for lines. They have their own, but it's actually trained in action. So Andrea team, it was the most diverse team in terms of using different types. They have audio, they have color, they have SIM, they have motion. So for audio, they use MCC and ASR with the Bible words for presentation. So they're quite diverse. The most diverse thing, like I said, in terms of using different types of features. Actually, India was the only team using the audio, and they successfully did that actually. So Ozichi University, we'll a little later explain further about it, but they were actually the only team some sort of semantic information. They have facial features, they have eye, like some visual representation based on eye and body focus. So it was interesting to see that, we will see later whether it really helped or not, but you know, this was interesting, like we were happy to see that some there are some efforts, you know, who are using it. The fourth ranked course at the Chinese University of Hong Kong, yeah. They use a sliding window. Like I said, this was another surprise that Ezra will explain. We did not see too many sliding window groups. Actually, two or three out of 11 submissions did use a sliding window. Now they want an mechanism for boundary information. So most of the other approaches still are going for a global representation for the entire video. That's not, again, what we're expecting to see, because we're expecting, you know, the videos are untrained, they're long, so a global representation might not be the best. But you know, that has been the trend actually this year, that not many sliding windows, not too much effort towards actually parsing this temporal information across the video. So, but besides the sliding window, something to remember from this paper is that they fine-tune their CNN on UCL. So even though it's not initially trained for action data, but they fine-tune it. USC, again, the pipeline, pretty, you know, common sliding window improving the Fisher vector in STM, but they mine for hardening in the background videos. The next method is it has the motion features in Fisher vector STM. They have seen that almost in all the submissions. So, but what they do is like the background foreground separation, and they have a separate pipeline for each of these, and they do that. That's a little different from some of the existing methods that they mostly are inclined towards using foreground more than background. Background is often discarded, but here they try to use both of them in parallel. And another paper from Nagoya, another submission from the university, they do shut down recommendations. Like I said, that's one of the few submissions that actually tried, made some efforts towards doing something specifically for untreated data. And they tried to recover the Fisher vector from the improved data species that they had. So the authors are here, would love to hear more about like how this recovery worked, what was the support behind the choice that like, it's, if you think about it, it's not a straightforward thing to do, and it's, I mean, there has to be some more justification explanation behind it. So we'd love to, it is interesting to see, we'd love to hear more about it if you're here also in the discussion. Also, in the end, the University of Florence, they used saliency in the features of furniture selection besides CNN, which is so I'm going to conclude with some trends in the messages, in the methods that we saw. So obviously, denser digital features are still got 10 submissions out of 11 are using improved nine of them, actually, nine of them improved furniture, and one of them basically.
At least he's using the pre-computed features to process that.
Well, by looking at the notebook paper, it was not completely clear, but we assume yes, because it's not straightforward. It's not really easy to compute these features from the videos. We spend a lot of like hours and hours and hours to extract features. I would say it should be very unlikely.
You said that context. You brought
context. That's actually one of the things that comes up in the end. So we don't know, like we are providing context features because obviously the storage, you know, all the things. How the Fisher vector is used, like did they find a Fisher vector representation on top of the context features? That's not very usual, like it's unusual way of using it. One of the teams tried to recover the Fisher vector from the, like you have the context features, you try to put together the vocabulary. So, like Andy, others who are going to speak later, I'm sure that by the statistically speaking, you have used, at least some of you have used Fisher vector. Please tell us how you use Fisher vector. We're interested in learning more about that. So yeah, denser features again, they're dominating. CNN, it's consistent with trend in the 40s. Use CNN in some way. So a few of the teams went beyond the logo. Like to see more of that. But it was great to see this year some things we took at first, like I said, some little semantic features, body, clothes, and facial features, and saliency, audio, and shutdown radio. So hopefully in the future we'll see like more of these and more actual features developed specifically for this kind of data. In terms of the machine learning classification part, SVM is dominating. 10 methods out of 11 use SVM, either kernel, SVM, or linear SVM. One of them is stream learning. I think we'll hear more about that later, why stream learning is important to SVM. And no completely connected CNN. CNN was just mostly just like features, and the features went to another SVM, not SVM, not that very important. And like I said, same point that Yvonne said, like 19. Fisher vector, like how we like to discuss it further. So yeah, I'm going to conclude here, but any questions I can answer, but we will, like I said, we'll have to speak before these teams sharing the details of their submissions about the top performance in here in this answer in Louisiana University and Chinese University of Hong Kong in Seattle. So,
so I'm curious about the data. You made some statements that context is important, and to some extent that example of the yo-yo. But to some extent, are you also trying to address the basic question that video-based recognition is a little bit ill-posed? Because of examples like that, that to some extent, as I said, all commonality between the two images was. Present, which is a good object categorization issue.
Right.
that's not really the video category.
Right. Well, ideally, like, as a human, like, when we look at a video, we know whether playing the yo-yo occurs or not. So ideally, like, besides only the motion features, like, which, like, the movement and hand and so on, the fact that the yo-yo is present in the video is some sort of, you know, cue for you to at least, like, think in your brain that yo-yo playing is happening in the video or not. So like I said, ideally, probably in the future, you'll see, like, a successful action.
So, but in semantics, that also kind of complicates it, because semantics would have assumed, again, based on some of the, you know, calculus, you know, kind of calculus, that his hand is the thing, that his hand touching the yo-yo,
right.
The yo-yo is moving around, so all of the constructs are there.
Right. But actually, those are cues for finding, like, or actually identifying that it actually happened. So, I kind of agree that this is, like, a loophole problem, in some sense, but I think the level that we are talking about, like for instance, you can agree that using this object information would probably help you distinguish between frisbee catch and like baseball catch. Because if you go with just simply the motion pretty much looks the same. You
That's
have
what
to
I'm actually pointing out that this might be a difficult question. Let me also ask another question. In the timing, the beginning and the end, most of the actions to show diagonal and stuff, it was trimmed. Really, the beginning of the action. What's
that's
kind
not,
of stuff based on?
Oh, you mean where the action, mm-hmm. the beginning of the action is defined? Well, that's also another question that we have been discussing, that we discussed this earlier. It's there, like, between the people in this room, there would be this agreement where the action, like when you're opening the door, does the action of door opening start when you're reaching toward the door or you're grabbing a handle? I think there's no clear answer to that question. For a system like, you know, action recognition, and as long as we keep the consistency, we should be fine. You know, the evaluation, training data, the test data, as long as we keep the consistency, you know, we would expect to see what you see in training and validation in the test, and, you know, do the evaluation successfully. But there's no definition, like, there's no clear definition of that. We have a few measures for avoiding that. So, George explained earlier today, we selected the 20 videos. 20 classes for visual temporal detection tasks in a way that they are less ambiguous in defining between the end of the action. Like some actions are more ambiguous, some actions are less ambiguous. Like brushing teeth, does it start when you are actually brushing your teeth, or you know where you're you know putting the toothpaste in?
So I think the question differentiates itself based on the application. If you're trying to basically come up with a classification, it might be. But if you're trying to get a robot to understand. Sometimes cutting it off like the frame, and this is what we learned on some of our stuff, was experts are very good at sports and say this is exactly what the thing started and mm-hmm. will end it. But
right.
sometimes systems that I actually use
that's
the features need a little bit more.
Right, that's one of the best relations to the second point of the thing, that we have a definition of ambiguous intervals in video. So here what our goal is to not train, first of all, not provide training data which are ambiguous. And also in the evaluations, you want to make sure that you don't penalize some certain systems without having like a meaningful reason behind it. So we have a notion of like ambiguous intervals. Those ambiguous intervals come with the annotations that we have. Don't exactly like specify the disagreements that you're talking about now. The participants can take them out of their training to make sure they're training in between part of the data. And also in the evaluations, we keep them out of their training to not penalize the some methods because of this disagreement here. So yeah, we have a few, like I said, selecting the actions in a way that they are better defined, like boundary being and better defined also some things. In the future, probably we will do some sort of larger scale application and come up with some statistics and the agreements of rent and breakers at the beginning and end of the action and so on. But yeah.
Thank you.
that term is not really good. It's not. You see some certain for the actions which are played with a larger portion of the video, there seem to be a higher likelihood for recognizing them properly, but you see the opposite trend as well. Like some of the action classes, they pretty much have the same duration, but they have very different recognition. It's not, the correlation is not very clear. Yeah, this is not very strong. I'm going to say this is the reason.
What if you actually remove the action itself, just run the test by the system, and the performance of all the sounds that don't necessarily.
Well, wouldn't that turn the video into a background video?
Well, I don't know how different the background video is.
Well, more or less the same. Like the background video, for instance, for the basketball dunk action, is usually basketball. Or some part of the basketball game in which the basketball dunk is not happening. So, well, I mean, obviously, you know, that brings up like a more philosophical question. If you cut that particular part of the action, maybe the part of the video immediately before that, but after that, have some sort of connection with what happens in that black area. Obviously, it does. You know, basketball is not completely independent. But I would say the background data that we have, in a reasonable way, captures that.
I am also, this is masked by the IDK features, which a lot of them are so tailored to this, they don't really care what's going on there. It's just that motion matches nicely in the piece you got in our editing, they would misfire the other people.
Oh, did you mean by masking that actually just the spatial part, or?
No.
So the entire chunk of the video you want to come up with? Yeah, that's